Peter G is going to serve as our moderator for this panel, and he's from Asian American for Equality and also a partner member from Project Charge, which many of us are involved in. So, and you probably will hear more about Project Charge and other issues that they have been working on.
Good morning. I'm really excited about being here today. My name is Peter G, and I work at Asian Americans for Equality. We're a comprehensive community development organization based here in New York City, and we're proud members of Project Charge. I'm really honored to be moderating this panel and a little humbled just because there's a lot of experts here, and they're really amazing folks. And so just thank you to the folks who are coordinating today's conference, the Center for the Study for Asian American Health, Charles B. Wang, Ari, and all the other sponsoring organizations. For almost a century, presidents and members of Congress have attempted and failed to provide universal health benefits to Americans. And on March 30th, 2010, after a year of intense debate between Republicans and Democrats and advocacy from all parts of the political spectrum, President Obama signed into law the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, legislation that will make remake this nation's healthcare system. Healthcare reform obviously has a large impact on the Asian Pacific American community, and we put a panel here together today to begin to summarize what that impact will be on our community, who was left out of the reform, how folks in our New York City have been organizing around these issues, and what will implementation look like. You know, I think a lot of folks are like, well, today's a conference about Asian American women. What does healthcare reform have to do with that? And you know, just talking with some of the panelists, it has an obvious impact on all of us, including Asian American women, especially since Asian American women are such gatekeepers in a lot of our families. And so this panel is extremely relevant. I just wanted to introduce the panel very quickly. To my left, we have the amazing Regina Lee. She is the Chief Development Officer at the Charles B. Wang Community Health Center. Regina is one of the co-founders of the center and is a member of the executive committee. And then to Regina's left is Noilyn Abesamis-Mendoza, the Manager of Health Policy for the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. Noilyn leads a health advocacy project to improve language access, cultural competence, and healthcare affordability. Among her major responsibilities is Project Charge, the Coalition for Health Access to Reach Greater Equity, a pan-Asian network of over 14 partners aiming to expand financial access to healthcare. And to Noilyn's left, we have Adam Gurvitch. He's a health policy specialist at the National Immigration Law Center. And Adam focuses on policies and advocacy to preserve and expand immigrants' access to health care and insurance. So after folks are going to be making some brief remarks, we're going to have question and answers. And so I want people to just, you know, we want to have a robust Q&A period. So folks should take their time right now to think of some pressing questions that they have, and whatever question that doesn't get answered in the brief remarks that folks will be giving, we want you to ask those questions right after that. We're going to start off with Noilyn. So I'm going to ask Noilyn to just summarize the health impact, the impact of healthcare reform on the Asian Pacific American community by providing some overview of the benefits and what it did not cover, and how the APA community in New York City mobilized around this issue. Let's give a loud round of applause for Noilyn.
So I will say, when I was standing in the back, it was a little bit hard to hear. So if you can't hear me in the back, just let me know and I can certainly speak up a lot louder. Again, my name is Noilyn Abesamis-Mendoza. I'm with the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families, and I'm also part of Project Charge, as Peter had mentioned. I want to thank the conference organizers for inviting me to be here today to talk about this topic. This is something that our collaborative has been working on for the past 2 years, so it's really great to be able to share with you some of the work that we're doing. There is a couple of materials that are being passed around, and I'm not sure if we brought enough. So in case you didn't get one, please let me know, and I'm happy to forward that information to you. So there should be a PowerPoint presentation as well as a green report. So again, if you don't have it, just please let me know. So I have the onerous task of going and giving a overview of some of the key benefits and challenges that, you know, we're facing with healthcare reform. So I'm going to try to do that as brief as possible, and you know, I welcome any questions that you might have at the end. So So I thought I would begin my presentation with really just talking about, you know, why should we care about healthcare reform? Nationally, there's 47 million individuals who are uninsured. One in five have trouble paying medical bills. And, you know, I think this goes without saying whether you're insured or uninsured, the cost of healthcare has been rising. And although, you know, many Americans like to say that we have the best care, healthcare in the world, we do spend the most when you look at other industrialized countries. Yet we have to also acknowledge that health disparities do exist for many of our communities, Asian Americans included. And bringing it home to New York State, from 2000 to about 2008, we saw a 97% increase of premiums. So again, you know, even those folks who have health insurance, we are continuing to struggle with being able to afford it. And, you know, back to the cost issue, 60% of all bankruptcies were a result of medical debt. And, you know, considering that we've been struggling with this economic downturn, health continues to be a top economic concern in many American families. So in terms of looking at how healthcare and healthcare reform is impacting Asian Americans, nationally there are about 2.3 million Asian Americans who are uninsured, and we find the highest rates being among the Koreans, Vietnamese, and South Asians. And so I wanted to pose a question out to the audience. Why do you think these three particular groups have the highest rates of uninsurance nationally? Any guesses? Okay. Sure. Right. Yeah. So many of these communities, it's the industries that they work in. I think someone also mentioned immigration status can also certainly impact that. When we look at New York City, one in eight Asian Americans is uninsured, but I think the takeaway here is when you actually look at who's uninsured, more often than not, they're those who are immigrants, so those that are foreign-born, 83%. And as was mentioned from the audience member, that, you know, while 65% of Asian Americans get health care through their employers, we do have to recognize there's a significant portion of those that are working in certain industries. So they're either small business owners, they work in cash-based industries like domestic work, or they're restaurant workers, or they're taxi cab drivers, and those tend to be industries that don't offer health insurance. And, you know, while we're looking at health insurance as one way to ensure access, access shouldn't just end at coverage. In the Asian American community, healthcare issues are compounded for a number of reasons, and as somebody had mentioned, it could be impacted by immigration status, language barriers, cultural stigmas regarding accessing public benefits, even if they are eligible, and as well as low utilization of primary and preventive services. And again, here is just a chart that breaks it down by some specific ethnic groups in the Asian American community. And what I thought I would do right now is also just give you some basic demographics of the Asian American community in New York City. And I want you to keep all of these demographics and these statistics in mind when you consider what made it into the final legislation and what didn't and how it's going to be impacting the Asian American community. So in New York City, there's almost 1 million Asian Americans. And we comprise about 12% of the city. And in my organization, we like to use this really fun factoid that 1 million Asian Americans is actually more than the entire population of San Francisco. So San Francisco is about 800,000 people. So when you think about not providing culturally competent, language accessible services, it's like you're not providing services to an entire metropolitan area. And I have a colleague that I work with that's based out in Rhode Island, and he always laughs whenever he sees the statistics because he says, you're actually bigger than our entire state. So that's, you know, some food for thought there. There's over 50 languages, over 50 Asian languages that are spoken in New York City. 4 out of 5 are foreign born. And though, you know, we have this unfortunate stereotype that all Asians are healthy and wealthy, that's really not the reality. When you look at New York City, actually 1 out of 2 Asian American children are actually born into poverty. And what is not up here is also that among our seniors, we have the second highest rate of poverty as well. As was mentioned earlier, 1 out of 8 does not have health insurance. And then back to language access, we have among the highest rates of being linguistically isolated. So what this means is that nobody over the age of 14 speaks English well or at all in a household. And I'm just going to go quickly through this. This is what Peter had mentioned earlier, that healthcare reform is really the combination of two bills that were signed into law by President Obama in March, and it really aims to provide affordable options to low and moderate income, and also to provide quality of care needed. One thing that I should mention is that, you know, with healthcare reform, it's estimated that 32 million people will now have access to healthcare. So this is really the meat of what I was asked to speak about. When we think about the impact of healthcare reform, I think, you know, overall for the Asian American community, it is very beneficial. And what I decided to do was really breaking it up into three areas. So access, affordability, and quality. So in terms of access, there were a number of provisions that were included in the final healthcare reform law around expansion of coverage. So the first is the Medicaid expansion. So now it's been increased to 133% of the federal poverty level. And I didn't include it in your presentation because I do encourage you, if you get a chance, to read our report where it actually breaks down many of the things that I'm going to be talking about. And also now childless adults will be eligible for Medicaid. The other key provision that will ensure access to individuals and families is dependent coverage. So parents can now continue to cover their children up to age 26. However, I want to note in New York, we go beyond that. You can cover your adult children up to age 29. So in New York, it's going to continue to be age 29. And then number three is employers who have 50 or more full-time or full-time equivalent employees must now provide healthcare benefits to them, or they will face monetary penalties. And in terms of funding for community health center, I'm just going to briefly go through this because we do have Regina here from the Charles E. Wang Community Health Center who could speak much more about the impact that it's going to have. But It's wonderful that there's going to be $11 billion in funding that are going towards community health centers. And, you know, this is really critical for our communities because these are centers that are neighborhood-based, community-based. They provide, culturally competent services. And they have a history of really addressing the needs of low-income and uninsured communities. So we're really excited that that made it into the final law. And then there's a number of provisions that are really looking at consumer protections and outreach. So, for example, there's no longer going to be exclusions for pre-existing conditions. Folks that have pre-existing conditions can now have access to health insurance. I do want to mention that starting this month, actually, that if states choose to create high-risk pools, they're able to do so for those that have pre-existing conditions. And then in terms of simplifying the application process, so now it's going to be a single application. So when you apply for a program, they'll be able to determine, you know, will you qualify for private insurance or, you know, will you qualify for Medicaid? So we're really happy that the simplification process was included. And then there's a number of outreach provisions that will ensure that there's going to be a website, a call center, and various print materials that are going to be provided to the community. And then around 5 minutes. Ooh, okay. Around prevention, again, there's a number of provisions that were included regarding prevention. And I did just want to mention a couple. So the first one is The National Prevention, Health Promotion, and Public Health Council will be established through the health care reform bill. And then over the next 5 years, there's going to be $7 billion that's going to be dedicated for health promotion prevention activities, which is really exciting. And in terms of affordability, there's a number of subsidies and credits that are going to be given to individuals as well as small businesses. So for those that make up to 400% federal poverty level, there's going to be a number of credits that are going to be available. Additionally, if you're a small business, so if you have 25 employees or less, or the full-time equivalent of that, you're able to qualify for tax credits that you can use to purchase private health insurance through the small business exchange. In terms of what's going to be offered for seniors, there is going to be a $250 rebate that I believe is starting this year to help fill the prescription drug gap, as well as there's going to be a ban on lifetime limits and annual limits. I will say that while it's going to be mandatory for most residents of the U.S. to have health insurance, there are some exceptions. So obviously the undocumented community is going to be exempt, as well as, you know, for those that can prove financial hardship, as well as, you know, there's going to be a religious exemption and a number of other things. And then in terms of quality, there are a number of provisions that are looking at increasing language access as well as cultural competency. So let me just go quickly through those that are included. So in terms of cultural competency, there's a lot of money that's being put towards the training of a culturally competent healthcare workforce. And you know, in the Asian American community, we like to always talk about that there's not enough data, appropriate data, that really reflects the needs of our community. But through healthcare reform, the really exciting thing is that any type of programs or initiative that is funded through federal dollars is now mandated to collect data on race, ethnicity. There's going to be oversampling. So this is really exciting for us to be part of it, and hopefully there's going to be a more accurate picture of the needs of our community, as well as there's going to be grants and loans that are going to be targeted to particular segments of the healthcare industry so that we can increase the number of folks that are serving underserved and vulnerable communities. And then I'm going to quickly go through this because a lot of the points that I'm going to mention, Adam is going to go into more detail. What I will say is, you know, there's a lot of positive that's coming from healthcare reform, but it shouldn't stop there. There's a lot of improvements, and there's some areas for concern that are very particular to immigrant communities that I had wanted to mention. So in terms of immigrant inclusion, I think this is a really key area where not everybody in the Asian American community is going to really truly benefit from healthcare reform. So in New York, you know, we don't have the five-year bar. So if you are eligible for Medicaid or other public programs, you can access it, you know, within your first 5 years. However, that's not the case. So the five-year bar still remains for many parts of the country, and I think that's going to continue to be a challenge. As I mentioned before, undocumented immigrants are being prevented from, you know, really engaging in this new healthcare system. So there's been a number of things that have been set up to ensure that they don't participate. And you know, one of them is around citizenship verification systems within the exchanges. And I know Adam's going to go into that in more detail. And in terms of language access, it's really wonderful that there was provisions that were included. However, there's not very specific recommendations about what are the standards to ensure language access, as well as, you know, reimbursement schemes to that, you know, plans or other providers can use to reimburse for language services. And, you know, what I will say in light of the budget deficits that we're facing in this state, as well as so many other states, we need to continue to preserve the safety net. I think it goes without saying we've seen a lot of hospital closings. We know that there's tremendous cuts right now at the state and the city level. for the public hospitals. So I think that's going to be continuing, that's going to continue to be a challenge, I think, for decision makers as they roll out the state implementation process and what does this mean. And you know, I think for me personally, oftentimes immigrant communities, Asian American communities, were kind of seen as like a special interest. So are they going to be providing these culturally competent services? Are they going to be able to expand language services or outreach programs that are specific to our communities? So I think I'm just going to end, you know, my presentation by just talking a little bit about Project Charge so that you guys can get a sense of some of the work that we're doing, and hopefully you all can join us too in our efforts as we move forward. So Peter had mentioned that we are a relatively new collaborative. We formed about 2 years ago, and it was through the generous funding of the W.K. Kellogg Foundation and the Asian Pacific Islander American Health Forum. They are a policy advocacy group that is based out of San Francisco, California, and they actually received that W.K. Kellogg grant. It was $16.5 million over the course of 5 years, and they were charged to redistribute it throughout the country to various states so that they can mobilize local collaboratives. And our group came together and we decided that we really wanted to address healthcare access. So not everybody in our collaborative actually does health solely. We have AFI, for example, who does a lot of work around community development. We have folks that just do immigrant services. So we decided it was really important to think about an overarching issue area that we can come together. Some of the activities that we did, so last month we had a state advocacy day and we had an opportunity to talk a little bit about the report that was there and some of our recommendations around state implementation to our decision makers at the state level. We also have done a public forum to release the report with Dr. John McDonough, and for those who don't know who he was really critical in the Massachusetts healthcare reform law, and he's actually now based in CUNY for, I believe, this semester doing a fellowship. So if you have an opportunity to get one of his books or to speak with him, I do encourage you to do that. And I think as we move forward, we really understand that for the most part, a lot of the Asian American community doesn't know what's going to roll out or these changes, and so we're hoping to continue to work with the media and figure out ways that we can let them know about these changes and continue to work with the decision makers so that we can ensure that the Asian American community's needs are really being considered as they roll out these state implementation plans, which are happening as we speak. And I don't know if you wanted me to add anything else, Peter?
No, I think that's great. Let's give it up for Noilyn.
Okay. Thank you so much.
So next we'll have Adam, and some of the key questions we're asking him to answer are like, what is the impact on healthcare reform on immigrant communities, and what are the implications to the cuts of the cuts to safety net services for our community? Adam also has a handout that we'll make sure that we'll get into your hands by the end of today. So just stay tuned to that. So thank you, Adam.
Thank you, Peter. Hi, I'm Adam Gurvitch. I'm with the National Immigration Law Center. I know many of you from my days at the New York Immigration Coalition. Thank you very much for allowing me to join you today. I wanted to talk first very briefly about who's in and who's out after healthcare reform, just so that we have a kind of shared perspective on categories of immigrants and what their options are going to be moving forward in order to get affordable health insurance coverage. And then Peter asked me to reflect a little bit on the impact of healthcare reform on immigrant communities, particularly undocumented individuals, as well as implications for the healthcare safety net. And so I'll try to cover that in the next 10 minutes. If it's possible to take down the PowerPoint, that would be wonderful. So very, very briefly, and this information is on the National Immigration Law Center's website. It's nilc.org, and you'll also get the handout. It's just a one-page summary of how immigrants are included in healthcare reform. Noilyn already touched on this, so we'll consider it instantaneous review. Naturalized citizens are entitled to the same health programs as U.S.-born citizens. As a consequence of healthcare reform, it doesn't change anything in terms of citizen eligibility. legal immigrants, the vast majority of legal immigrants are lawful permanent residents, people who are here through the sponsorship of an immediate family member who's either a U.S. citizen or lawful permanent resident. About 10% of lawful immigrants are people who are here with humanitarian status, refugees, asylees, and a number of other categorical immigration statuses. For legal immigrants, healthcare reform, well, they get included in all of the broad kind of public health types of changes that will affect the ability of healthcare providers to offer services. But in terms of eligibility for health insurance coverage, legal immigrants remain barred from the federal Medicaid program for their first 5 years, most legal immigrants. It's a little bit confusing because in New York State we don't have a five-year waiting period. That's a result of litigation. So in New York, legal immigrants are entitled to Medicaid, Family Health Plus, Child Health Plus without any waiting periods. But if you're in Texas and you're the spouse of a U.S. citizen and you're waiting, you're a lawful permanent resident and have not been in that status for 5 years, you're not entitled to Medicaid, even if you've been working and paying into the system. And that's the case in about half of the states. So that doesn't change. Healthcare reform does not remove the bar on legal immigrants from Medicaid for adults. For children, legal immigrant children and pregnant women, depending on the state they live in, they could be entitled to the CHIP or Medicaid program right away without waiting for 5 years. Again, unrelated to healthcare reform. Healthcare reform doesn't do anything to change children's eligibility. It's a state option. This went into effect in January of 2009 with the CHIP program reauthorization at the federal level, where if a state elects to cover lawful immigrant children and pregnant women in their first 5 years, then in that state those kids can get covered. If the state doesn't elect to cover those populations, then they have to wait 5 years. And again, this is all legal immigrants. In the health insurance exchanges, which won't really come into existence from a national perspective until the year 2014, legal immigrants will be treated the same as citizens. There are no waiting periods currently in the law, although just to jump ahead to what we need to do, we need to really defend that eligibility because every spending bill, every legislative vehicle that moves through Congress, whether it has to do with health or immigrants or completely unrelated, it could be a defense spending bill, is going to possibly include attempts by conservatives to limit legal immigrants' access to the exchange and impose waiting periods, perhaps a five-year waiting period there. So that's not the case in the health reform law, but it is something that we'll need to keep our eye on and defend. So that's a summary of what legal immigrants are eligible for. Undocumented immigrants, healthcare reform doesn't change anything on one level in that undocumented individuals are still forbidden from enrolling in Medicaid, Medicare, the federal CHIP program. They are not going to be permitted to purchase health insurance coverage through the health insurance exchanges. Even if they wanted to pay full price and use their own money out of pocket, they're forbidden from doing that. That was the White House's innovation in healthcare reform. And undocumented individuals, again, remain barred from the public insurance programs after health reform is fully implemented. So so that's the broad overview. In terms of the impact that healthcare reform will have, in particular on undocumented individuals, there are some bright spots in that there is an expectation that more employers might provide coverage, especially small employers, to their workers that provide health insurance coverage where the employer pays a portion of the premium, and that makes the coverage more affordable for workers. Probably most of the folks in this room who have health insurance are in exactly that situation where your employer pays the bulk of your premium and you pay a portion of it. And if healthcare reform succeeds in expanding employer-based coverage, that's likely to help immigrants across statuses. In the individual insurance exchanges, there's not going to be good news in that unauthorized immigrants are categorically excluded from the individual exchanges. In terms of emergency Medicaid eligibility, I don't really like to think of emergency Medicaid as health insurance because it's not. It's a reimbursement stream that goes directly to healthcare providers. It's not like an individual gets a card and can show up and get medical care and then have that care paid for, although that would be a great system in New York State and it's possible to achieve that. We don't have that set up. So emergency Medicaid is basically where someone who doesn't have, who's low income enough to qualify for Medicaid but doesn't have the right immigration status, when they're treated for a medical emergency, their healthcare provider can fill out the applications and seek reimbursement through the state for the cost of that care. Because Medicaid income eligibility will be expanded, as Noilyn mentioned, to 133% of poverty, that's significantly higher than the current Medicaid income eligibility levels. And what that means is that in 2014, when the Medicaid expansion goes into effect, many undocumented immigrants who can have their emergency care paid for through emergency Medicaid, many more will become entitled to have that care paid for because currently they're earning 100% of poverty or 120% of poverty. They earn too much to be eligible for federal Medicaid. In the future, their income will qualify them for emergency Medicaid. So that's good news for healthcare providers and as well as to a limited extent for undocumented individuals. There's the good news about increased funding for federally qualified health centers. The community health centers are mandated to have an open door policy and provide care to everybody. We're going to hear a lot more about that. And they're outstanding resources in the parts of the country where they exist, particularly important for folks who are limited English proficient, who are uninsured, in being able to receive care in a culturally competent and accessible way. And so the increase, very significant increase in funding for federally qualified health centers is very good news, as long as that money flows to the health centers that are serving our communities. So if federally qualified health center money is targeted towards parts of the country that are going to continue to have a large number of uninsured residents, then that's really good news. I was at a presentation yesterday where the Alan Aviles, who's the president of the New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation, mentioned that they estimate that 60 to 70% of the uninsured patients treated through the public hospital system in New York City are unauthorized immigrants, undocumented immigrants. And there was a representative from the public hospital in Nassau County who also estimated that 70% of their uninsured patients are unauthorized immigrants. And what's going to happen in theory with healthcare reform is that people who have the right immigration status are going to be either brought into healthcare coverage. If they're currently uninsured, they'll be brought into coverage either through expanded employer-based coverage, through individual subsidies where they'll be allowed to purchase insurance through a health insurance exchange, and if their income is below 400% of the poverty level, which most uninsured people have income below 400% of the poverty level, they'll be able to get some subsidies in the form of tax credits. And so that's a big mechanism to bring a lot of people into coverage, people who have the right immigration status. The expansion of Medicaid will bring in a lot of lower income people who currently are there. They may be working three jobs, they may be earning minimum wage, but they're too rich for Medicaid. And so a lot of folks who are just struggling economically and currently can't get into the Medicaid program will be brought into Medicaid as the Medicaid income eligibility levels are expanded. Again, that leaves out undocumented immigrants. And so what are we looking at in 2014 and after? We're looking at a system that's very similar to what we have now, where in inner city areas and rural areas, we're going to see pockets of uninsured individuals. An increasing proportion are going to be people who don't have the right immigration status, because people who have citizenship or are lawful immigrants are going to be able to get coverage through the mechanisms that we've been discussing. So the residual population of people who will be uninsured, the Congressional Budget Office estimates about 21 million people will remain uninsured after healthcare reform is fully implemented. At those 21 million, about a third of them will be unauthorized immigrants, and the remainder are likely to be people who are working part-time or seasonal, people who work in the cash economy and can't document their income, people who are mentally ill and homeless. So the most marginalized individuals will be the individuals who remain without health insurance. And there's nothing in healthcare reform that changes in any meaningful way the ability of people to get financial assistance at hospitals or clinics. There's nothing in healthcare reform that that subsidizes care for people who will remain uninsured. And in fact, there are about $50 billion in cuts to safety net hospitals through the disproportionate share funding, which is called DSH. So you might have heard, or might not have heard, throughout the healthcare reform discussion that hospitals are going to be facing significant DSH cuts. These cuts are going to kick in, the largest cuts start to kick in 2017 and 2018, so we have some time to sort out what the financial position of the safety net is going to be. But once these cuts happen, they're going to take tens of millions of dollars off the table that currently subsidize hospitals that provide care to large numbers of uninsured people and large numbers of Medicaid patients. So again, the hospitals serving low-income communities, folks who use Medicaid by definition are limited income, they're low income, and the majority of reimbursement for safety net hospitals typically comes from Medicaid and from some of these supplemental funds like disproportionate share funds. As those funds get cut, it creates an extremely concerning situation where we'll have in New York City, for example, our public hospital system, in many urban inner cities and in some rural areas, where the safety net hospitals, the public hospitals or the private hospitals that have an open door policy, start to have their supplemental funding cut, and they don't see a corresponding decrease in the number of uninsured patients because they'll continue to be the locations where large numbers of undocumented individuals live, we face a potential financial crisis in the safety net. So what do we need to do? We really need to keep our eye on that issue in particular, as it's going to be a number of years during which the federal government's going to make choices about how to allocate funding to federally qualified health centers, to safety net hospitals, to reduce funding for safety net hospitals. And we want to be very vigilant so that we can try to influence the way that the federal government implements these funding reductions. We want to protect the hospitals that truly provide care to large numbers of uninsured individuals. There are many hospitals that we in New York would consider to be very elite hospitals, very prestigious hospitals, that draw down a significant amount of these funds, even though in reality many of your constituents, many of your family members would have a very difficult time getting care at these providers if they don't have insurance, whereas they can turn to many of the public hospitals and many of the safety net private hospitals, voluntary hospitals that truly have a community benefit mission, and people are able to get care there and are able to get financial assistance to pay for that care. And we want to start to focus more attention on this issue and try to influence the way that funding flows to the safety net so that it protects those facilities, those providers that are really there in our community and without whom we would be barren. If we think about places where public hospitals have closed and where the private hospitals, they let people into the emergency room, but they're going to charge cash for follow-up services, that's not really a functional healthcare delivery system, and we don't want that happening in New York or elsewhere. So that's, I guess, what I'd leave you with. I guess to sum up, I think healthcare reform on the one hand creates some amazing expansions of coverage. It potentially improves the ability of providers to focus on quality of care and to streamline some access to health care for people who will be entitled to it. But for many undocumented immigrants, it'll remain just as difficult a situation, if not worse. Thank you.
Let's give it up for Adam. And now we have Regina, who will talk a little bit about the impact of healthcare reform on health centers like Charles B. Wang.
Good morning, everyone. Can I just have a show of hands? How many people in this room are affiliated with a health center, either as an employee, as a patient, or as a board member? Quite a number of you. Okay, for those of you who may not be familiar with FQHCs or federally qualified health centers, let me give you a 1 minute overview about who we are. As Adam mentioned, FQHC is a part of the nation's safety net program. Being an FQHC means that we are either located in a medically underserved area or serve populations that are federally designated as medically underserved populations. We are governed by a consumer majority board of directors. And probably the most important thing you need to know about being an FQHC is that we never turn away any patients for lack of ability to pay. We work very closely with our patients, particularly with uninsured patients, to make sure that finances are not a barrier to access. We also don't ask anyone for documentation of their citizenship status. We serve everyone, regardless of your citizenship status or your financial status. Many FQHCs, including Charles B. Wong Health Center, Morris Heights, Nina Ryan, Nina Chelsea, all of us have outreach programs because we're really committed to linking people who are medically underserved, people who face language, financial, cultural, or transportation barriers to high-quality primary care services. So all of us provide enabling services, outreach, health education, care management, transportation assistance. That's our mission, really to reach people who are medically underserved, to address health disparities in our communities, to make sure that everyone receives high-quality care. So the good news in healthcare reform is that there's going to be $11 billion allocated to federally qualified health centers. The bad news is that we have five years to spend this money. I'm being somewhat tongue-in-cheek, but let me give you a little perspective on what this $11 billion means. Community health centers in the United States, the first community health centers in the United States were established back in 1975 by a young physician named Jack Geiger. When Jack Geiger was a medical student, he spent some time in South Africa. And he observed that in South Africa, there were these neighborhood clinics that offered primary care to people who were low income. So he thought to himself, well, this model probably can work in low-income neighborhoods in the United States, both in urban areas as well as in rural areas. So he came back to the United States, and together with another physician named Count Gibson, they persuaded the Johnson administration through the Office of Economic Opportunity to fund two demonstration projects, one in Columbia Point, Boston, and another one in Mount Bayou, Mississippi. And the selection of Columbia Point in Boston was in fact very strategic because the community health center movement gained the support of the then junior senator from Massachusetts, Ted Kennedy. And during the more than five decades of his service to the United States, Senator Kennedy was a strong, avid supporter of community health centers. And part of the reason for the growth of the community health center movement was really due to Ted Kennedy's efforts. So fast forward 45 years, the community health center movement is now an established federal program. There are currently 1,200 community cell health centers in the United States operating approximately 8,000 service sites. In federal fiscal year 2010, the discretionary funding for community health centers was about $2.2 billion. The stimulus funding last year awarded approximately another $2 billion to community health centers, mainly for capital improvement, some for service expansion, and some for information technology. So right now, the grants for community health centers in the neighborhood of about $4.2 million. What healthcare reform means is that over the next 5 years, the community health center movement would have to double its service capacity. So think about this. It took 45 years of advocacy and hard work to develop our current infrastructure. We're a challenge within the next 5 years to double our service capacity to reach the goal of serving 40 million people in the United States. Currently, the community health center movement serves approximately 20 million. So we're excited by this opportunity and we feel enormously challenged. But all of us in the community health center are ready to step up to meet this challenge. So what does it mean for community health centers? We really have to engage our board of directors to figure out how to position ourselves to take advantage of this new funding. We have to have projects in the pipeline already. We don't know at this point how the federal agency, HRSA, which is the Health Resource and Services Administration, plans to allocate the money. We think that some of the funding will be used to adjust the base grants for community health centers. Some of the money would be used for capacity expansion, to set up new service sites, and also to fund new health centers. I'm sure HRSA is working very, very hard right now to make the policy decisions, to develop the grant announcements. The first grants are going to be awarded in federal fiscal year 2011, which starts this October. So HRSA has to get out $1 million to the system in about 1 year. And having been on both sides of the table, both as a funder and also as a grant seeker, I can tell you that it's just as hard to award money as it is to apply for money. So HRSA has an enormous challenge to get the money out, to step up its technical assistance, to step up its performance monitoring. Health centers also have an enormous challenge. As I mentioned, we have to engage with our board of directors to do strategic planning. We also have to have projects already in the works because the implementation schedule is very, very short. In the past, when HRSA released grant money for capacity expansion, the grant requirement is that we have to get new services up and running within 120 days after the notice of grant award. So you have to do this on a very fast track, and it's going to be extremely challenging for community health centers. Because community health centers will also be receiving a lot of new grant dollars, we're going to be subject to a lot of public scrutiny. We expect more performance monitoring, more audits by the Office of the Inspector General, more reporting requirements. Everyone in Congress, every taxpayer deserves to know whether or not community health centers are going to be successful in meeting the performance goals, serving 40 million users, providing high quality clinical care. So we're very excited about this opportunity, and we feel also very challenged. But I also just want to say that healthcare reform presents opportunities not only for FQHCs. There's also lots of opportunities for people who are involved in primary care. For example, there's going to be $1.5 billion allocated to the National Health Service Corps. National Health Service Corps will provide scholarships and financial assistance to medical students, nursing students, dental students, physician assistant students who are interested in primary care, who are willing to work in medically underserved areas after their graduation. As of a few weeks ago, we were informed by HRSA officials that they have more money than they have applications. So if you are a medical student or dental student, nursing student, please check into the National Health Service Corps and apply. There's also going to be money for prevention, $7 billion prevention money to be spent over the next 5 years. There are no guidelines at this point about how that money will be allocated, but we know from the statute that small businesses are going to be eligible to apply for some of that grant money to develop wellness programs for the employees. So that's an opportunity for those of you who are working in nonprofits. You may not be an FQHC, but you might think about partnering with small business to develop workplace wellness prevention programs. There's also going to be a lot of money for private practice. Healthcare reform will have funding for medical home demonstration projects. New York State Department of Health has already announced incentives for private practice, as well as Article 28 diagnostic treatment centers, as well as FQHCs. If you are able to get certified as a patient-centered medical home, and the certification is done by the National Committee for Quality Assurance, NCQA, there are 9 standards for certification, but practices that are certified can get enhanced Medicaid reimbursement per visit. So the enhancement is anywhere between $5 to $21 per visit, depending on your level of certification, the 3 levels of certification. So the opportunities for private practice as well. So I think to wrap up, my advice to all of us is, if you're an FQHC, be ready. Work with your board, work with your staff, be ready. And look for opportunities to really use these resources to have an impact in your community. If you're involved in primary care, if you are in private practice, if you're a health advocate, look for opportunities in healthcare reform for your organization, for your community. And all of us, as Noilyn and Adam both mentioned, all of us should really be involved in monitoring the implementation of the healthcare reform legislation, because it's going to impact all of us. We have to make sure that our community members are educated about both the benefits as well as the responsibilities on the healthcare reform. We have to engage small businesses. Small businesses will also have to step up.
There are subsidies, Noilyn mentioned. There are subsidies. There are opportunities for small businesses that wish to provide health insurance to their employees. So lots of opportunities, lots of benefits. Just stay engaged and become educated. Thank you.
So we have 10 minutes for some questions and answers. Are there anyone in the audience that has a question? There's a lot of folks here, so there has to be at least one question. Yes.
Noilyn?
You said there was a person who invented CUNY.
John McDonough, McDonough.
Are there other questions? Yes.
The question is for Evan. Since you mentioned about the 5-year bond, like every state, like 2 years is not 5 years, but I would like to know
So the question was, is there any internet resources to find out which states have the 5-year bar?
So that's changing all the time because state legislatures are cutting immigrants from their state benefit programs. But the National Immigration Law Center, where I work, has on its website at nilc.org the updated list of states that provide coverage to different categories of immigrants, and it goes through state by state, so that's the best resource that I'm familiar with. But you have to, if you really want to know, you have to really know what's going on at the state at a particular moment.
Mm-hmm. Yes, over here. So the question is, what are some of the thoughts about, for a lot of folks, so they might be just taking the penalty versus, since it's going to be less than the actual cost, HMOs, et cetera. So what are your thoughts on that?
It gets complicated in the law, but there are provisions where if the insurance that they're being offered, for example, through their employer, if the employee's contribution would amount to more than a certain percentage of their income, then that enables them to go to the health insurance exchange to try to purchase coverage there. And it's really unknown how cost effective the coverage will be on the exchange. It's also the case that people tend to want health insurance once they develop a medical problem. So it'll be a very subjective decision. If somebody has a chronic condition that they want to manage and they know that they're going to have ongoing medical and prescription drug expenses, they're likely to opt for insurance coverage in order to protect themselves from many of those costs. If somebody perceives themselves as being healthy, they may be more likely to choose to pay the penalty and remain uninsured. But that's very much going to depend on how the exchanges are created in each state, it would seem. So healthcare reform doesn't change anything in terms of how employers provide coverage to their employees and the dependents of their employees. It creates funding mechanisms to make coverage more affordable. It provides incentives for more businesses to maintain or begin to provide coverage to employees. But there's no secondary verification in the workplace. So the theory is that an employer verifies every employee's right to work. So whether or not any of us are work authorized is something that's supposed to happen when we're hired for our job. Once we're hired, once we've overcome that verification hurdle, then if the employer offers health insurance benefits, that's available to employees typically. And health reform doesn't change that basic setup. If I can make a general point that that healthcare reform basically sets a floor, not a ceiling, meaning healthcare reform says that at a minimum states have to do this and states have to do that, But states like New York that have much more ambitious and protective insurance regulations get to keep those additional protections. So the federal law will speak to what sort of benefits an insurance plan has to offer in order to be eligible to provide coverage through the state exchanges. In New York, if we want to demand more from our insurance coverage, we can do that. So the federal law says that insurance companies will have to cover dependents up through age 26. In New York, if we say insurance companies have to cover dependents up to an older age, we have that right under health care reform. So it's really worth looking at where New York has been out in the lead and has done more, and making sure that we defend the good things we already have for all the problems. There's a lot of really very positive health insurance regulation and standards in New York, and we don't want to see insurance companies start to view, or state regulators start to view, federal health care reform as a basement that we can sink down to.
Just one other thing that I would add. I can't underscore how significant being able to cover your children up to 26 or 29 is, especially considering what's happening in our economy right now. We're finding so many young people who are graduating college who are unable to find jobs. When they don't find jobs, they're more likely to be uninsured. So I think, again, I just wanted to underscore what Adam was saying. We need to continue to fight to keep these really wonderful, progressive laws that are in place within our state.
And Regina, do you have any closing thoughts?
The question someone raised about the state exchanges, I mean, I think the challenge in healthcare reform is, yes, and obviously a lot of benefits, but I think that there's a lot of unknowns, which is whether in the end we're going to be successful in containing costs. Our ability to expand eligibility, to expand coverage, is really dependent on our ability to contain costs. And given our track record in curbing Medicaid, Medicare, and healthcare costs, it's going to be a tremendous challenge for all of us to look for cost savings and to make the system more effective and more efficient. So that's going to be the unknown question. And I think all of us should really be actively engaged in monitoring the implementation of healthcare reform, particularly how the state exchange system is going to work. Project Charge has already committed to take on this goal of monitoring the implementation. We don't know at this point what New York State is going to do. The leadership is going to come out of the governor's office, and we know that the governor's office right now is going through a lot of changes. We don't know who's going to be in charge, which department is going to be in charge of the state-run exchanges. But we need to pay attention. I mean, the issues are very, very technical. We need to pay attention to make sure that New York State uses whatever leverage it has to provide products in the exchange that are in fact affordable, right? If we end up having products in the exchange that are not affordable, a lot of people are going to say, I'm going to pay the penalty, or I'm not going to even pay the penalty and just take my chances with the IRS, because the products will end up being unaffordable. So that's going to be the key issue for us. Yes, it's great. We're going to have $11 billion for community health centers. We're going to have all this money for prevention. But really, the key is state-run exchange.
And on that note, I think we are right on time. So let's give it up again for this awesome panel.